In its heyday, Discovery Bay, like most of the Caribbean, is teeming with life. At the top of the food web is a gamut of predators. Sharks, snappers, groupers, and jacks cruise near shore to feed. They are drawn by a tempting menu living on the reef. Surgeon fish, parrotfish, and other herbivores that graze algae growing on the coral. But this Discovery Bay lives only in photographs. All that's left to remind us of how vibrant this reef once was. Today, the hunting grounds of the big fish, the coral reefs, are dying, suffocating under a shaggy layer of algae. To figure out what caused this collapse, Aronson and Precht need to know if the coral die-offs have occurred before.
Because I'm a geologist, my education has trained me to look at the fossil record and try to pick up clues. An obvious place to look for the answers was in the geology of these reefs.
Reefs are built from colonies of tiny animals called polyps. Only the top layer of a reef is alive. Beneath are skeletons of past generations. As Aronson and Precht descend, they're traveling back in time thousands of years. Within this coral necropolis is a long record of the reef's health, a kind of medical chart. Aronson and Precht grind out a section of reef. This tube will capture over a millennium of history.
What we look at today is just this two-dimensional living surface, or in this case, dead surface, of a coral reef. And what we want to do is go down through this third dimension of time and try to reconstruct what that looks like historically.
It may look like nothing more than mud, but within, telltale pieces of coral are preserved.
It looks like it was perfect. Just buried yesterday. It's just unbelievable.
All the coralites are perfectly preserved.
Amazing. So
for the last 1,000 years, the coral was healthy. But something unprecedented appears in the 1980s. The coral stops growing, recording when algae began taking over this reef.
What we see in these cores is that the composition is constant. The types of corals and the condition they're in is constant all the way up to the very tippy top of the core. And beyond that, boom, everything is different. So that indicates that something's happened in the last few decades, looks very much as though it has to do with human impact.
Pollution is often a suspect when it comes to environmental problems in the sea. But fisheries biologist Daniel Pauly is focusing on another factor in Discovery Bay.
So is it cheaper?
Different type.
Different type.
In a nearby Jamaican fish market, Pauly seeks clues to the reef's collapse.
They've been hanging the whole morning, haven't they? Yeah. These are people
come in and little kids, they would like one small one.
Yeah. Haven't they been bigger before? I mean, if
yes, you don't have any bigger ones.
When you were young, did you have more big ones? You remember big fish in the market?
Or? Yes.
But generally, you don't see them much, the big ones.
You have a lot of them in the market regularly?
No.
They've only from time to time.
In the Caribbean, I've heard many times people say, oh, the Jamaican, they love small fish. But it's not so. It is that it's all they have. And that's why that's what you find in the market. That's all they have.
For Pauly, the absence of big fish is of critical significance, although sellers here have accepted it as normal.
You can have a young woman working the market, having the impression there's lots of fish there because she works hard, right? But what her grandmother was selling, she doesn't know really. And therefore, she doesn't know that there is far less available. But it matters to us, it should at least, because it tells us that something big is happening.
The disappearance of large predatory fish is part of a bigger pattern, one that connects this dwindling market to oceans worldwide.
What would surprise people about the state of the ocean is how devastating fishing itself is. It is the force that impacts on ecosystems most. It is now known that in the last 40, 50 years, we have lost about 90% of all large fish throughout the world.
And Jamaica was not immune to this worldwide trend.
In the 70s, there were offshore banks and offshore waters that belonged to Jamaica that were completely unfished. What was there at the time were especially big groupers and snappers. The big groupers are really the most sensitive organism on reef. They are the first to go.
What would happen as boats continued to remove big predatory fish? Pauly might have expected some kind of chain reaction. He knows that on land, we might have seen an explosion of herbivores taking over the system. But he will never know if the same thing happened on the reef. That's because we kept fishing down the food web, removing not only large carnivores, but also their prey. The prey fish, the herbivores, are vital to reefs. Their grazing helps keep fast-growing algae in check. As fishermen removed them, only one significant grazer remained, the spiny urchin, which soon succumbed to a disease. And now the fished-out reef could no longer resist a devastating outbreak of algae.
And then, in a sense, the whole pyramid is eaten up from inside, keels over, and you have no reef, no fishery, no ecosystem, nothing. In that sense, there are many, many spots of the ocean that are empty, and these spots are spreading.
Is Discovery Bay a warning of the future of coral reefs around the world? And if so, what can we do to change the course? On the nearby Caribbean island of St. Lucia, the reef is in much better shape than Jamaica's. But still, fishermen here are already paying a steep personal price.